And then anybody over a year, they would have to go to the food line with the other children to get the rest of the food. So they did a good job with that, and we didn't have any problems. We had, I worked in my CHOP. We had the rest of our team there. There was another nurse, but then there was an environmental science officer, and then they had an inspector for the food that was in that tent, and then of course the preventive medicine officer, physician, was located. His office was there. And so we all friendly, we exchange, you know. And one of the things that happened is we did have a foodborne outbreak there, and a very small one. We got it, nipped it in the bud because, you know, all the food's cooked outside and there's dust and dirt flying around. And they were able to, within a day, we were able to find out that, you know, where they had eaten, because we had several feeding stations. And they had made the soup, and instead of putting it right in the refrigerator, he had left it there to cool, and it evidently stayed out too long at the heat. But it wasn't, you learn from those lessons, you know, and I think it wasn't a serious thing at all. We were able to take care. We nipped it after just a few people were sick. Mm. And so we knew right away what the problem was, you know. But that's how good it is to have people who are skilled in those fields that know, you know.
And, you told me a story how a family was in need of some care, and you asked for the family to arrive at your tent.
Oh yeah, yeah, yes. Well, yes, that was interesting. We did a lot of screening for communicable diseases, one of which was TB, which is prevalent in many other countries, and so we found that that one of them had an active case of tuberculosis, and so we wanted, and that person was in the hospital. The hospital told us that the person had TB.
Sure.
So I had to do follow-up on all family members to make sure nobody else in this family had TB. So I went out, and they're such nice people, and I said, you know, would you bring your family in so I can test them and check them out? And if they were under 14, we would put a skin test on them. If they were over 14, chances are they had a positive skin test, so we didn't want to do that. We'd got x-rays on them. So anyhow, he brought his family, and there was 29 people.
Aunts,
and
uncles, of course, grandma, grandpa.
everybody. And you know, it was cute because, of course, I told you I'm working with these other men.
Sure.
And they said, well, what are you going to do now? And I said, well, I'll tell you. I'm going to tell them to go back to the tent, and I'd be right back, right down there. And we'll take care of them right there rather than bring them. Just stay in one place, and that's what we did. But it was just, it was so funny, and they all started laughing, all the men did, when they saw all these people coming, and they said, they bring everybody with them when they come. They don't leave anybody behind, you know. Yeah. So we did follow them through, and of course, the person, was cared for in the hospital because that person needed attention, yeah. And they had a few of those, but you'd find those, in any community, but, this was all new experience for them, being tested. And then we had an outbreak of measles, because they had not ever been exposed to that, so we gave immunizations. We didn't have anything serious like typhoid fever or anything, measles. Now, I did have one in there where they got a worm out of a child that's this long, and I got a picture of it.
Yeah.
But generally speaking, because initially, most of the people that came were from Saigon. But then I did tell you that we had a boat come in with all these people that didn't speak any English. And I thought it was, rather interesting. And they needed a lot more help. You know, they needed interpreters. I forgot what I was going to say, what I was going to tell you about them. Oh, they came because they were frightened that if they stayed, they were going to be. So they came. And they didn't know where they were going or what they were doing. And so their exposure maybe to communicable disease was a little bit more prevalent than you found with some of the others. Mm. One thing I found very interesting to me as a nurse was, I was, just previous to this, I had gone on a special mission to Thailand. Mm-hmm. And in Thailand, I'd say there was one mother out of all those mothers I saw that that didn't breastfeed their baby, that you had a bottle. They all nursed their babies. These people, they didn't nurse their babies. They all had formula. You heard me talking about formula?
Mm.
That's it. It was a rare occasion you find one. Well, see, they were city people. They came from Saigon originally. Mm-hmm. And for some reason, that's the way it was. Mm. And so, of course, we had to make formula. And that, you know, created somewhat of a problem because their formulas are different than ours. Mm. And fortunately, they were smart enough to send pediatricians. I worked with two wonderful pediatricians there that really understood kids and knew about these various things. And so they cut the formula, put more water in it for these babies so they wouldn't get diarrhea. Mm. I mean, all the things you got to think about, you've got to adapt to another culture. That's what the whole thing
is. That you would take for granted with American children are completely foreign.
Yeah, mm. Yeah.
So approximately when did you leave Guam? Mm-hmm.
I left Guam, and we were there for 62 days. Mm-hmm. So that puts us sometime the end of June, the first part of July, I guess. Yeah.
And you came back to the States?
Yes.
And you were posted where?
I came back to the States for vacation. I reported back to Walter Reed, where I was located. I had to go back there. I closed up my apartment in Washington, and I took leave. And then I went to Hawaii to be assigned to Hawaii. And I was there for 2 years.
Mm-hmm. And you retired what year?
I retired 1986.
And you achieved the rank of full bird colonel.
Right. Right.
So now you're still involved with the military in a way that most people don't get to help, and that's working with veterans.
Yes. Yes.
And you do that where?
I actually am part of a ministry at the with St. Mary's Church. Actually, it's a Catholic churches, a cluster of Catholic churches, which includes St. Philip's, St. James, and St. Mary's. And we would like to invite other denominations to join us, or anyone who wants to join us. But right now we have a good group, and we're about 2 or 3 years in operation, and we actually do a lot of work with the Veterans Shelter in Worcester.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Veterans Inc. now, but we bring lasagna dinners there to them. 2 weeks ago we had a picnic for them as well. We try to help families that a member of their family has been deployed to Afghanistan. We don't do as much of that as we'd like to do. We'd like to get to know who they are, and is there a way we can help them, maybe get someone to mow the lawn for them, you know, that kind of thing. But prior to this ministry, I was very active. I belonged to the Worcester County Military Officers Association, and for 8 years, there was a group of us that did lasagna dinners once a month there when that shelter first opened.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've been involved with that veteran shelter, and I've seen it grow. It really has. And they have grown. This shelter in Worcester has grown because now they've bought new property. They're over on Grove Street in Worcester, 69 Grove Street.
Mm-hmm.
That was the only one I knew of. But now they have also purchased a place over in Shrewsbury, retreat center, and they're opening up a center there. They also have one out at Fort Devens area, and they have one somewhere else in the city of Worcester. So what do they do there? They're very good with these veterans. They're people who don't have another place to live. They take them in. They can't be on drugs or alcohol when they're in there, and they actually counsel them. They get them ready to go out on their own. And so I think they're doing some good things to help them, to get them off the streets and help them to get back to living again. Getting jobs, they actually help them to find jobs, get an apartment, think about and be independent again, which is good. So we enjoy working with them. Our committee is made up of, that's on this ministry that I'm speaking of, are people from St. James Parish, from St. Philip's, and also equal numbers from St. Mary's. We've been written up, it's in the paper, we've been putting in the papers, you know, let people know that we exist, but it takes time for it to catch
sure
up.
Sure does.
Yeah.
So let's get the word out there to see if we can get some folks to help volunteer. If you would like to offer your services or volunteer for this worthy project, you can reach the Veterans Ministry of Grafton's Catholic Churches at 508-839-3993, and the number will appear on the screen. And the person who runs that organization, his name is Bob Descagno. Mm-hmm. And please, if you can offer your services, if there's anything you can do to help, please pick up the phone and give them a call. I'm sure they'd appreciate it.
I need to, if I can include this, we rotate the leadership. He happens to be the leader right now. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Oh, we don't want to take any power away from him. We'll leave him in charge for now.
I haven't talked to Bob about it, but he'll be pleased. You should interview him.
Well, hopefully this will help out a lot.
Yeah.
Well, I'd like to thank you for coming in. I really enjoyed talking to you, and I hope the viewers at home got a lot out of our conversation tonight.
Yes. Well, thank you very much for asking me, and that's good. Yeah.
Thank you very much once again.
Yeah.
And that concludes my interview with Grafton's Anna Federico and her experiences in the United States Army as a nurse. Thank you for watching once again. I'm Bob DeToma, and remember, we're all living history right now.
Producer Bob DeToma.